Hello everybody, I think I will put this headphone because there is a bit of interference with the other room. So it's a nice experiment for me because I never have spoken in this way, but it's kind of interesting. We will have kind of telepathic connection one with each other, and I hope you can hear me well. And of course, I hope also that we will have a great interaction at the end of my talk because for me, it's really important to know also your point of view and also what you think about all these subjects. So, first of all, I would like to introduce myself. Of course, I've been already deeply introduced by the Republica team, that actually I thanks for this invitation. And I would like to say that I am a kind of hybrid person because I'm coming from different backgrounds. And from one side, I've been working as part of the hacker community in Italy and also being interested in the discovering it in Berlin since 10 years. And I've been down these bots working as a curator, but also as a researcher. But at the same time, for me, being a researcher, a curator, had always a specific meaning, and this meaning was to try to investigate critically media practices and see in which way they could be connected at the same time with art, but also social politics. And of course, when I speak about politics, I'm not speaking about the usual party politics. This is a tradition that we bring along with us coming from Italy, but politics for us means also to have an attitude connected to experiencing society and culture critically. And so this is a bit what has been accompanying me in all these years. And I've been recently published two books. One book is called Disrupting Business, that have been co-edited together with Jeff Cox, and another book is called Network Disruption. And this is a bit the book that I'm going to speak and present today, and also something that you will freely download, hopefully, from the internet if you find this interesting. So I will go on by briefly tell you that this is the main scheme I'm referring to, and we will go back to this later. I'm just briefly explaining that I'm not somebody that is coming from a business school, so I'm not a business person, but I'm interested in understanding what business concepts mean applied to art and culture. And so I am referring specifically to the concept of disruption innovation that has been developed by Clayton Christensen of the Harvard Business School in the 90s. And this concept meant to deal with a process that disrupts the markets in an unexpected way, and also to generate a product that the market does not expect. And this concept is something that I'm bringing directly to what I refer with art and hacking. So we will go back to this kind of scheme after the talk. And so I start from the beginning. This is me in 1999 when I was attending a hack meeting in Italy. This was really a great time in which we believed a lot about cyber utopias, the idea of the computer to the people, and also fighting to think about technology as a tool to empowering society and politics. And so in Italy, this is a really long tradition that, of course, comes also way before as a form of criticism related to art and culture and politics. But in the 90s, we started really to develop something that was related to cyberpunk utopias and also to the idea of cyber rights as a tool for freedom. But then what happened? In 2001, maybe some of you have experienced what I also experienced, that was many demonstrations that happened from 2000 to 2001, starting in 1999 with Seattle, demonstrations related to the fight against power and politics in the G8 context. And this is an image that comes from the Genoa G8 in 2001. And unfortunately, I have to say that for me, this has been a really critical experience, even if I was not in Genoa as many people, that actually was got really the worst. I was in Florence running with some people of the Strano Network Collective, an independent radio, and we were connecting directly with Radio Gap, that was the radio that was reporting what was happening. And so I assisted as many people live when the police zooped inside the media center. And was actually something that was from one side really making them move and reflect what are we actually doing? Is really this the right path we are taking? Because the idea was really to be frontal, have an antagonistic approach and trying also to fight this enemy, trying to assault the red zone and these kind of things. And to be sincere, for me, this, and this is really speaking personally, was a sort of a failure, because at the end we end up doing the game of the police. And so I was really wondering, is this the right strategy that actually we should bring along, or maybe there are different strategies that we could reflect upon? And so from one side, I think the Genoa 2001 was a big blow for the movement, but was also a starting point, because there were many other groups that started independently after that time, and also many other collectives that really rethought what they were doing. And my particular experience here, I think the pink color is not so strong, but has been trying to reflect on different kind of practices. And I found a kind of new hope in the pink and the queer movements, trying to reflect on strategies that are not just confrontational and oppositional, but strategies that are really trying to be transversal and fluid, and also somehow to disrupt the system from within, trying really to work with identity in a way that is critical, and also questioning what is identity, questioning the dialectic as a political struggle. And also this is not something completely new, because in Italy there has been a long tradition related to this kind of attitude, this kind of practice. And so I always really like to bring in the context I am the image of Luther Blissett. I don't know if you are really familiar with that, but Luther Blissett has been a multiple name that people were starting to adopt around middle of the 90s, and the idea was that everybody could become Luther Blissett. This image that's is the portrait of Luther Blissett was basically creating by morphing different other image, and so it's a fictional identity. It's somebody that is that people could appropriate and also embody to try to somehow disrupt the system from within. And what many people were trying to do was really to apply the idea of fake plagiarism, also disruption inside the media system, because often Luther Blissett was creating some pranks that were really directly going to interfere with what journalists were doing, what politicians were doing, really try to demonstrate that actually media are a construction. And if you understand that, if you do understand the logic of them, then you can really try to somehow detourn the logic, also coming back to kind of avant-garde perspective. And at the same time, there is also another part of history that I like to quote here, because also Luther Blissett has not been the first. There has been also other examples before, like the New East Network and the research project that started in 1979 in Canada, in Montreal, and then also spread all over Europe. For example, also here in Berlin, there have been many New East really active. And Neoism was also something that was referring to the idea of creating a multiple identity. And this was Monty Kansin. And at the same time, going in US, there have been another really interesting disruptive, if you want, movement, or basic or better parody religion, that was the Church of the Subgenius. And so I have here also another icon that was familiar for many at the end of the 70s, during the 80s, that is Bob Dobbs. That is the also an icon representing a way to disrupt the system, and in this case also through rituals and as I say, a parody religion. And I'm still back a bit on history, and we could say that also many of these projects were interpreting networking as a collective participation that was coming from grassroots movements. And I often show this image that is an image created by the postal artist Vittore Baroni. The name is Organic Tree, made in 1992. And he was already speaking about the idea of networking as a practice that was involving many postal artists around the world. They were exchanging materials, postcards, stamps, and many other do-it-yourself projects. And this kind of tradition is also coming directly from other avant-garde, like Fluxus, the Situationism, Dada, the Futurism, the visual poetry. But in that time, in the 90s, many people trying to create networking by using the media that at that time were really used as a tool of expression and also do it yourself. And for example, we have photocopiers, computer, phone, fax, video, cassettes. I mean, I'm sure you remember that. Happened then something else that I will define my second big blow, that is the coming of Web 2. And I explain it why, because from one side, Web 2.0 in 2004 changed completely the idea of referring to networking. I mean, many of new of you know, and also there's been a really positive outcome of that, because much more people know how to deal with networking, what networking is, and we are all much more connected. But at the same time, also, we have to say that is a completely different idea of social networking in respect of what we were actually thinking about in the past. And it's an idea of social networking that is pretty centralized, because, of course, it's mainly controlled by different companies. And so, I mean, for some of you would be something great, for others would be actually something to question, especially now trying to reflect on the discourse of surveillance and also privacy. I think already now we are experiencing something that actually many people coming from the hacker culture already knew long time ago. So it has been not really a surprise for people active in the hacker culture to know that you are constantly surveilled. And so what did I do? I tried to investigate also this. I mean, try to understand where is actually coming from this idea of networking really connected with business, and the idea also of a centralization of network practices, and in which way we can really understand networking as a disruptive business. And so I went to San Francisco and to Silicon Valley. I was doing a visiting scholarship at Stanford for some months, and I met some many interesting people there that actually told me that, I mean, this idea of, hacking completely disconnected from business is a bit of an utopia that many European people have, but is absolutely not what many people in the US think. When, for example, a lot of history of hacking has been completely intertwined with the one of business. If we think how the Silicon Valley developed, even as the first BBS developed, and so if you remember the history of the Homebrew Computer Club, for example. I met also Fred Turner there, that we had a lot of interesting conversation related to the shift between counterculture and cyberculture in California. And he actually explained to me that we are speaking more about a layering here. It's not an opposition, but it's a layering. That means that many people are actually doing things that are contradicting themselves, but they do at the same time. And the Burning Man is really an example of that. I don't know if you've ever been there. It's really big gathering of people once a year during August in the desert of Nevada. And this for me has been a really interesting example, because Fred was connected to Burning Man with Google in his speech, really reflecting on the fact that a gathering like that is actually really functional today to the ethos of Silicon Valley, because there are many companies going there. It's actually a big business because, you know, you have to pay kind of high tickets. There are like 50,000 people, even more now, that go, and each of them pay more than $100 tickets. And so you can imagine that is a big business. Of course, there is a lot in infrastructure, but at the same time, you know, it's also something that grew exponentially from the first experience that were pretty disruptive, like the Cacophony Society or the Suicide Club, that have been really the one establishing a bit the idea of Burning Man. And so what Fred was telling me, by looking at Burning Man, actually, is an example that now business is really working with disruption, because from one side, is empowering a community, but from the other, is completely, you know, creating a revenue from that. And in that sense, Burning Man is a clear example. Also, I would say many people working at Google go there, also many people working at the Silicon Valley, because it's a moment of freedom that people can experience, but also is a big moment of networking for Silicon Valley companies. So I developed something, and going back to my scheme here, that I call the art of disrupting business. And so I say, maybe we would change the structure, we should also change the political perspective, because to be antagonistic, oppositional, for me doesn't work anymore, because we have been already understood that business has appropriated a lot of rhetoric that was really pretty used by hackers in the 90s. And so instead of being confrontational, that is actually, I think, is something you just lose your battle, it's better to be disruptional. And what I'm speaking about is a model in which, from one side, artists are trying to disrupt business by working on the system from between, and at the same time also business is creating disruption by creating also innovation. So this is my disruptive feedback loop that's I'm going also to explain now with a different example, and involves directly in different layers artists, hackers, activists, entrepreneurs, and also networkers. So one example that I also like to bring is, of course, Napster. And I think Napster has been a great example of a disruptive innovation, because in 1999 really introduced the idea of file sharing in a way that became kind of massive, because the people really trying to interpret the music industry in a different way. So I think that's Napster, that was also really accepted a lot from the hacker community at the beginning, I think is really showing how this layer of perturbance is actually working. And then, I don't know if Stallman would be happy that I say that, but I think also GNU Linux as an operative system has been really also a disruptive technology, because introduce in the market completely something that the market didn't expect, and really disrupt what in that time was the Windows and Apple business. But how do we connect this with artistic practices? And in my book, I'm trying to analyze different concepts and also different case studies that are all working with the idea of disruption. So from one side, they are disrupting the business because they are interfering with that. And from the other, I'm actually analyzing a project that creates business by making disruption. And I can also give you a specific example. Then if you are interested, you can easily download my book from the internet. But two examples that I always like also to bring are the Seppuku artistic project and also Anna Damolo. So I start first with Seppuku. Seppuku was developed by the Italian collective L'Alliance Invisible, especially Jonathan Quintini and Clemente Pestelli, in collaboration with the design group Park of Yellowstone. And it was something that they launched in 2009. They first presented at the Cher Festival in Italy and then also at Transmediale. And their idea was really to try to understand how Facebook work, and especially what is behind the code when you create your login inside the system. And they were really working on this tension between the open and closed nature of social media, and also trying to work on these unpredictable consequences that are generated by disruptive use of it. So basically, by doing your login, you are going inside Seppuku, and you could create your virtual suicide. So Seppuku is actually a Japanese virtual suicide, actually physical suicide. That means you have to cut your belly, and has been also used by the Luther Blissett project in 1999 when they declared the ends of the project. So they took again this kind of practice and they say we should all create our suicide in Facebook. And this became really viral. So there were many people that were doing that, and was interesting because they were really using and appropriating the code of the login of Facebook. But at the same time, when you were committing your suicide, basically you were canceling yourself from Facebook. And also you were receiving a high score, more suicidal people you were managing to create that were following you. And the question was really, I'm actually really able to leave my virtual world with Facebook. And at the end, of course, was kind of easy way of trying to reflect on that in the sense that I think also this was intelligent from their side, because they say, okay, you can create your Seppuku, but then if you want to go back, you know, you can. You just do login again, you are back in Facebook. So for them, it was not really the point of disrupting completely Facebook, but they wanted to make people reflect on what to use Facebook means. And also what means to create friendship in Facebook, how you can use the code of Facebook. And of course, they received from Facebook a cease and desist letter, and the things went on for a kind of long time. Another example that I like to bring you is the Anna Damolo project, and they were also coming from Italy and working especially in that time, like 2008, 2009. And basically, Anna Damolo is the acronym of Onda Anomala, that in English could be translated with Anomalous Wave, and was a movement of different students that were protesting against cuts of education, research. That's actually was a phenomenon that is still happening, but became really massified during that time. So there were a lot of protests, not only in Italy, but also around Europe and the world. And so they created somebody that was a fictional identity, this Anna Damolo that you can see on the screen. Anna Damolo also is trying to reflect on what means the idea of creating a virtual character that could be used to become viral and also could be appropriated by people, not refusing the fact of being Facebook, but really trying to understand how Facebook works and trying to turn it to your own advantage. So they created something that was appropriated by a lot of students. We had both the graphic logo of Anna Damolo and also the different, you know, morphing image that created a real person that people use to turn back their profile of Facebook into Anna Damolo. And people were claiming Anna Damolo is the new ministry of Minister of Education, University and Research, and we are occupying the ministry at the moment. And so they created also the defacement of the website, and were allowing people to leave different messages by using a telephone line that they also build up. And from these different messages of the experience of the people being Anna Damolo, they created also a book that was published in 2009. So why I'm speaking about that? Because I think that all these projects really are explaining us something kind of specific, so that it's possible to disrupt system from the inside, especially trying to look for the holes and the vulnerability of these systems. So I'm here having a quote of a really interesting book from a Canadian researcher Richard Day that wrote this book named Gramsci is Dead, and he's writing, there will be always holes even when there are no longer any margins. And I think that is a bit the form of disrupting business I'm speaking about, so really trying to reflect what are actually the holes that we could infiltrate, and in which sense what are the different experience and intervention that we could imagine by really understanding how technology work, by understanding what is the code behind the interface. So when Anonymous came, I was of course really happy, because I think that this was exactly showing that a certain, I don't know if people were really familiar with Luther Blissett or Monty Kansin and the Nihilism, but for me, somehow this different entity that you cannot even call a movement was replicating some of these strategies by really reflecting on the vulnerability of system and also the discourse of anonymity. That was a really important aspect of these previous practices that I told you. And then, so the question for me becomes, is really important to be effective in politics, in culture, and also in the media struggle. And I think that maybe we should also question what is the effectiveness dialectic, because I don't think this works anymore, and this makes us really an easy target. And I think we learn from Luther Blissett, from Nihilism, and they all were saying it's really hard to see any truths, and by seeing, questioning what is the truth, then you have to really try to create new form of strategies that could disrupt the system. And I'm also bringing you another example. This is a project that I was curating at Transmediale 2013 and has been developed by the Telecomunistan Collective, by Raum Labor Berlin, and also by a huge network of postal artists. This was called Octo P7C1, and was a pneumatic system that we created by connecting different stations inside the house, the culture, and the Welt. Was something that the Telecomunisten also call the official miscommunication platform of Transmediale 2013 by following their idea of miscommunication. And I think in this idea of miscommunication, in the fact that you can really question a system from the inside, but also being playful and ironic, there is also the answer I was looking for. And this specific project, maybe I just describe you briefly, was something like a reflection of a social network system, especially the idea was that there was a corporation, Octo, that was trying to imagine a worldwide pneumatic post system that was connecting different households. And we were doing like the beta testing at Transmediale by connecting the different rooms of the house, der Kultur und der Welt. And was really a centralized system because there was a main station and different peripheric station, and you could exchange the capsules that were traveling inside the pipes by really, you know, administrating this station. But was also really, if you want, a coexistence of opposition project, because was from one side dealing with closeness of system, from one side with openness. And the idea of openness was related to the presence of the male artist, because Vittore Baroni, this postal artist that I mentioned before, collected a lot of presence of many postal artists around the world that actually sent to us a capsule. And this capsule that could travel around inside the pipes could be open, and inside there were some instructions that the people, the visitor, could perform. So it was also an interesting interpretation of how to perform something that is traveling inside a closed system. And I was also really happy when at the last Chaos Computer Club, there were some people that went on with this project, and they created a new version of that that was completely open, distributed, and also based on the do-it-yourself idea that they call Seidenstrasse. Probably if you have been at the CCC Congress, you have seen that. So I would like to finally to conclude with two examples. I mean, one example that also think is really interesting in this kind of discussion on how to learn to be pervasive and how to understand that reality is made of different layers is the work of Trevor Paglin. And we have been collaborating recently in a panel of Transmediale that I was curating together with Jake Applebaum and also Laura Poitras. And specifically in their discourse of art as evidence and also in the discourse of the photos that Trevor does of drones, there is the idea that actually art could become a tool for evidence, but at the same time, reality is not something that you just can see from one perspective, but there are really many perspectives you can work with. And this is actually a photo of drones, and you don't see them, but they are there. And that is why I think the example of Trevor is really along this line, because he's really showing you that maybe what you can do is try to reflect on the unpredictability of reality and also on the fact that there are different layers of interpretation. And these layers of interpretation are not so far away from you. You know, they are on the sky. And if you have different eyes, you can actually see them. So how is possible to disrupt the system from within by understanding really how the system works, how you can see what is around us with different eyes and also understanding that art could be a form of evidence. So this is my new project that I just tell you briefly because, I mean, I'm just launching it now. It's a Disruption Network Lab and I'm planning to be active in the next months, hopefully years, at the Y Art House in Berlin. And I'm reflecting on really how to create a curatorial program, but also a hub of research and practice related to the idea of disruption that I'm speaking about. How to create a coexistence of opposition, and how actually to invite people that are really questioning the truth. Because I think that you know, truth is something that could be seen from really different angles, and there is always somebody that has actually more resources to throw to force the truth on you. This is also something Dimitri Klein always says by speaking on venture communism. And so maybe instead of really trying to have a truth that is more truth of the truth of who people that have power, you should really question what the truth is and question by understanding how to create different layer of interpretation. So I just conclude by saying that if you are interested in this subject, you can go to that website where there are my different books and you can download them and yeah, enjoy and thanks a lot. And also I hope you have really interesting questions.
Yeah. Thank you, Tatiana. Are there any questions in the room?
Don't be shy.
Yes.
Hi, thank you for your talk. You said that art alters businesses by interfering with them.
Mm-hmm.
Can you just specify this a little bit more? Is it like entering the DNA of businesses and how do businesses react to them? I mean,
I think when I speak about that, as I say, I'm referring to the idea of disruptive innovation. So the idea of introducing in the market something that the market doesn't expect. And if you go back on the history of art, especially the avant-garde, this is exactly the strategy that the avant-garde were making, really working with the unexpected, with the unpredictable, and try to disrupt the system from within. And I think also we had a really great example during these days with the keynotes opening of the Yes Men, because I think since many years now, because they have been really active in the net art scene, they have been questioning the discourse of business by interfering with it, because they really understand how it works. I mean, they know how to infiltrate because they study the logic of it. And at the same time, they understand how to work with your identity, with your perception of yourself in trying to enter the mechanism of business. So it's more like a strategy. You know, I have not a recipe for the successful business here, because as I say, I'm not a business person, but I think that business, especially today, really show how to be pervasive. And, you know, I think even the social networks, companies, and Web2O is really showing us how to do that. I mean, trying to use something that is disrupting a market that we know. But it's also something that business has been doing since many years. If you think about, you know, the advertisement agency, there have been a constantly cycle of reappropriation also of the so-called counterculture in the 60s. And so my point of view is, you know, this is nothing new. Reappropriation is something that always happened, but business change, because now it's become really flexible, pervasive, and it's also actually working a lot with openness, do it yourself, social networking. So I'm telling the people, doesn't make sense anymore just to be antagonistic, because, you know, there have been somebody that has been faster than us. So I think actually you should do the other way around, trying to appropriate business. So it's also a matter of language. For example, when I was speaking with a lot of activists at the beginning, they really didn't like my work, you know, because I was coming from a tradition of more antagonistic practices, and they didn't like I used the word business. I said, why you have to use the word business to speak about radical artistic practices? We don't like this word. And then I was saying, actually, that is why I'm using it, because I think that we should start also appropriating the language that we are dealing with. And so, actually, what is business? And if you go into the etymology of the word, then you see that actually business has a really different connotation, because business means being busy, being somebody that is constantly trying to achieve something, and that has to do with anxiety, with really, you know, trying to do something all the time. So it's not immediately something to do with economy. And so I think, okay, maybe we can also start reflecting on this specific word. And when, with Jeff Cox, we published this anthology, there are really interesting contributions. Like, for example, Franco Berardi Bifo is saying, he's really demonstrating how nasty could be the word business if you really bring it on yourself, and trying to imagine that actually we are now working all the time, because also when we use a social medium, we are working, you know, because there is somebody that is making a profit from our relationship. So there are really a lot of layers of interpretation, and I'm also coming from more a kind of situationistic approach, in which I think that not only media, but also language is not neutral. So, and I think business really taught us that, because all the first Web2O convention I went, I remember there was one in 2004 here in Berlin, and also there was Tim O'Reilly. They were really speaking about hacker culture. And I was like, what? How is possible? I mean, for me, it was really something that was coming from another perspective, because I was coming from Italy, you know. And we always say that hacking was something else. So that is why I say, wait a second, maybe I have to start going back here and understanding that this kind of discourse is made of different layers, and then trying to bring it back to the community I'm coming from, and also trying to see if there could be people that could be inspired by this way of seeing the reality, you know. But it's also not something that I invented. There is really, as I say, a long tradition of artistic practices that are dealing with that. I am just advocating that there will be even more, because I think that the idea of the truth as a unicum, a holistic concept, is actually really dangerous, because you could be really attacked by somebody that claim that has a bigger truth than yours and more powerful. And there is always somebody that is more powerful than you. So I think instead of being in this dialectic, maybe it's better to go outside of that and trying to enter the system of what you are trying to criticize from the inside.
Any other questions or additions, inspirations?
Yeah, thank you for the talk. I was wondering if you feel that this strategy is more likely to be adopted in certain cultures, or if you feel it's like a very, you know, if some cultures and scenes are more open to it, like geographically.
I don't know, because in my research I was really trying to map different perspectives. And then, of course, there was a limit, because I could not investigate, too much. And, of course, I'm missing a lot of perspective coming more from Asia, other countries, the South. But I would say that there is a really interesting dialectic between the history of net culture in Europe and what it was in US. But still, these things are speaking, you know, because I think they actually feed each other. And I was also having an interesting conversation with Jake Applebaum about that, because he was the one that really suggested me the idea of the mutual feedback loop, when in 2009 he was working, was part of the Noise Bridge Collective of San Francisco. And he was telling me that actually, you know, a lot of hackerspace is not Noise Bridge, that was really particular, because it was more coming from kind of European tradition of anarchism and also politics, were actually in US supported by Microsoft, Google. And initially I thought, wow, how is possible hackers are actually happy to get money from Microsoft and Google? Actually, I'm not here in this convention supported by Microsoft, so I don't know. I think that maybe we should go also beyond this way of thinking, because maybe it doesn't matter anymore, you know. And what they were telling me was, at least in this discussion, many hackerspaces, especially one in Mountain View, that I don't know if it's still existing, probably yes, it's called Hacker Dojo. They were telling me, but we don't have no problem to get this money, at least we can also be free to do what we want. So there is a really different perspective there. Instead, I would say in hackerspace in Italy, at least the one coming from more political tradition, would have always refused to have money from Microsoft or Google. But personally, I think that this way of antagonistic perspective doesn't bring anywhere. So I think that instead we should more work on the interferences of these different cultures. And that is why I'm questioning what is business disruption. And I actually think, as I say paradoxically, that we should learn from business in a way can be really effective and pervasive.
Yeah, thank you again, Tatjana, for this detailed input again. Take the chance to ask or to give us some more ideas about hacktivism, hacker culture.
Thank you very much for your speech. It was really interesting. What I miss is who is the enemy? I assume you don't accept the word mm-hmm. enemy, because you're talking about disruption, but what is then the final goal? Who take advantage from this disruption, and who is affected by it?
Mm-hmm. No, as I say, I don't think we should think about in terms of enemy anymore, because this is again a way of working with politics and culture and technology that is completely dialectic. And I think this form of antagonism, I hope I demonstrate, doesn't work anymore nowadays. And so I don't know actually who could benefit of this. I can see that there are many artists that are already using the idea of disruption. And it's actually something that's really proper of the hacker ethic, because all the hackers have been always working by trying to disrupt the system from within, trying to opening up the system, trying to understand what is inside. I mean, the so-called hands-on perspective of hacker culture. So, you know, from one side, it's not something new. It's just something that I think maybe we should acknowledge and trying to also experience directly by embodying it. And so it's from one side an artistic input that I'm giving, but from the other side, I can also tell you that a lot of business companies are actually working with disruption already, because it's a concept that comes from business. It's really, I mean, the basic of how many advertisement agencies work, also startups. So I don't think I'm saying something new for many companies that are here. And I've been also recently invited in Italy last year to actually speak with people that are doing business. I mean, I was invited from the Omnicom Media Group, that is an advertisement company that is worldwide, and there is a section of it in Italy. And they were really interested in these things. They told me, yeah, we really want to know what you think about business disruption. Can you tell us your point of view? Because we work on disruption by, you know, referring to products. In fact, the companies that were there were, you know, there was the Barilla, the Clinique, Renault, really companies that are selling products. And initially, I was wondering, okay, I don't know if what I'm actually bringing there is something that they will be really interested. But then by having a dialogue with them, I understood that it was the case, because I could also see what was on the other side of the coin, and also have a really interesting dialogue with people that are doing something coming from a different perspective. But still, we are speaking about similar concept. So in that sense, I say we should work by bringing oppositions together and trying to highlight coexistence of oppositions. And then, in that sense, I think, you know, of course, then you decide what is your enemy. Is it more a personal interpretation of that? So, but I think that at the same time, it's also something that's, you know, is more related to your specific background. But in the more bigger picture that I'm presenting, I'm also thinking that we should go beyond this antagonistic structure of power contra power, because I think was already demonstrated in many situations that then at the end you end up doing the game of the people you want to oppose. So, okay. Some other question, or we go all to get a coffee?
Okay, if there aren't any further questions, I would like to thank you, Tatiana, again, mm-hmm. for her very inspiring talk.
Thank you.
Here for us.